Random House Audio presents In 50 Years, We'll All Be Chicks by Adam Carolla. Wait a minute. I'm Adam Carolla. That's right. A lot of these highfalutin celebrities get voiceover guys to come in here and do the heavy lifting for them. But not me. I came in, and I'm gonna do it myself. So sit back, relax, and enjoy, because baby, this is gonna be good. Let's get it on. Let's get started. Now, for those of you who know me, you know I'm a horrible reader. No, I don't have dyslexia. I'm just dumb. What's wrong with being dumb? I didn't learn to read, so I'll be goddamn if I'm going to read 300 pages and bore all of you with it. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to riff. I'm going to vamp. I am going to rant. And that's the way you wanted it anyway. But I am going to read one page. And that's the first page of the book, because I feel like it's concise. It takes all of my thoughts and puts it into a little Pez dispenser. And then for the rest of the book, look out. So here goes. For far too long, I've stood by idly and watched a problem in this country get worse and worse. I'm talking about the pussification of America. We've become self-entitled, thin-skinned, hyper-allergic, gender-neutral, view-watching little girls. What we used to settle with a little common sense or a fist, we now settle with hand sanitizer and lawyers. Masculinity, by any definition, is disappearing. My fear is that in 50 years, we'll all be chicks. Uh-huh. Get it? That's the title. I didn't read that part. That was one of my famous vamps. I've written this book in hopes of a course correction. If just one person reads this book and demands a salad with a hard-boiled egg and without goat cheese, it's the only cheese that tastes like the animal it fucking came from. That's not written here either, but I'm getting fired up already. If just one person reads this book and decides to change his own oil, if just one person reads this book, slips in a supermarket and doesn't call an attorney, then I've done a horrible job and my family's going to starve. I need to sell a shitload of these things. Now, a little bit about the author, or as I like to say, moi. That's Mexican for me. I grew up in the San Fernando Valley, which is actually where I'm recording this book, probably just about 2 miles away from, well, the Taco Bell I was rejected from. That's right. I put in an application at a Taco Bell on the corner of Magnolia and Colfax across the street from my high school, which in hindsight doesn't seem like a great plan, sitting around serving bell beefers and tostadas to guys you went to high school with. But either way, I put an application in at the Taco Bell in North Hollywood and was rejected. Do you know what you have to do to be rejected by a Taco Bell manager? You understand this concept? You are not Taco Bell material. I know you're 15 and a half and you just sprung your first pube and you're struggling with your sexuality and you're not getting laid and you're too small to play high school football. But here's some good news. You're not Taco Bell material. I'm convinced if you went in to apply for a job at Taco Bell, filled out an application by just wiping it between your ass cheeks and then handed it back to your manager by holding it up to his neck and shoving a pencil through it so that it went in one side of his neck and out the other, he would still hire you on as an employee. But no, not the North Hollywood Taco Bell. Rejected. So I ended up working at the McDonald's over in North Hollywood. Either way, I was 15 and a half. And I digress. And boy, there's going to be a lot of digressing. As a matter of fact, if you don't like digression, hang up right now or unplug or jump into a river because there's going to be some digression going on here. As a matter of fact, I don't even know what that word means, and I know I'm going to be doing a shitload of it. where was I? Grew up in North Hollywood, which has the word Hollywood in it, but may as well be in Kansas. It really has nothing to do with the business or the industry or Hollywood in general. Although Bob Urich, the guy from Vegas, was about two blocks over from where my piece of shit house was. I don't know what the fuck he was doing living in North Hollywood when he was doing SWAT. But either way, grew up in North Hollywood. Did I mention that? And just a working class community. My mom was very depressed. I think she would be severely depressed by today's standards. I think if a 14-year-old Dr. Drew could have diagnosed my mom, he would have definitely put her on some Zoloft. But either way, she hung out in her room a lot, locked her door, and yelled, "Freak out." She was a child of the 70s. So she had, I shouldn't say a child of the 70s, a retarded adult who lived in the 70s and who basically followed the rules of the 70s, which is a lot of depression, a lot of blaming the man, and a lot of hatred of white people and white bread. She had something called a biorhythm wheel, and she would look at that biorhythm wheel and decide whether it was a good day or a bad day to leave the house, and that thing was always set on extra critical. So I'd say, like, "Hey, can you give me a ride to Van Nuys in your VW Squareback that gets vapor lock and has retreads on it?" And she'd say, "Let me check the wheel." And then she'd come back. Bad news. Extra critical day. So by the way, you should spend your extra critical day just sitting in your bedroom with no box spring, by the way, and rotting. I lived in a house in North Hollywood that was 100 years old at the time, and that was in the 70s. So now it's like 500 years old. I didn't do well at math. Point is this. Sometimes you sit back and you sort of take a tally of your life and you think, wow. You know that thing you do when you think about your dad or you think about your mom and you go, wow, I'm their age now that they were when they were doing this to me. What the fuck was wrong with them? I lived in a house that had two front doors about 8 inches apart. I suspect that maybe someone was running a dentist office out of one of them or a doctor's office. It was real little house on the prairie shit. I don't know why it had two front doors, but it was one of those turn of the century things. But it only had one bathroom, and my room had the washing machine, no dryer, because we're not the Carnegies, for Christ's sake, just a washing machine, no air conditioning in the house, no heat in the house, and the electric meter was inside of my bedroom. That's right, it was a converted service porch, and so the electric meter was actually inside of my closet. So the meter reader, once a month, would have to come inside of my room and read the meter. Very Green Acres-esque. Anyway, very depressing. And one of the things I discovered just recently, I was doing a little math and realized not a box spring in the entire house. And that's a bad sign. My mom slept on a mattress that was on the floor. My stepdad slept on a pull-out sort of bad 70s Brady Bunch sofa conversion thing. My sister had a weird loft thing that my grandfather built her with her bed up on a piece of plywood. And then I had a cot mattress on this other bed that was made of plywood. So one TV, two front doors, one toilet, and zero box springs. Very, very bad equation. Oh, and the water heater was inside my room as well. So I had the washing machine, the water heater, and the electrical meter all inside my room, which is the size of a midget's fist. Now, where was I? That's right, North Hollywood in the 70s. I wasn't a good student. I was a bad student. I couldn't read or write. That was a big problem. You see, I went to a hippie school, and it was a sort of hippie free-range school where they didn't believe in rule.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.